It is my honor to have the legendary Dennis Chambers, drummer extraordinaire, with us. Dennis, I appreciate you taking the time to come to Make Weird Music.
Man, glad to be here. Glad to be here.
Awesome. Awesome. I'm going to start with the elephant in the room because of the way the world is right now. How is the how has COVID affected you, and how are you handling things?
I'm handling it very well. I pretty much just, make sure I keep a mask on, keep my, wash my hands and stuff. But for those of, a lot of people don't know that I'm a liver transplant survivor. I had a liver transplant five or six months ago now. And I was very blessed to receive a liver in a very short amount of time.
I see. How are you feeling?
I feel fine. I feel better than I felt in the last 18 years.
Fantastic.
But going through that at this time, it's very weird, especially with COVID around and being in the hospital, and it was very scary moments.
I can only imagine. I was thinking, even from a standpoint of every other musician, the gigs just aren't out there to be found right now. You can't play here, you can't play there, but you had other priorities as opposed to worrying about being, gigging.
Yeah. I mean, the situation is what it, it is what it is. But for me, I had a lot of, since I went through all of that, I had a lot of stuff I had to put on the back burner or put it on hold.
Right.
And now I am at the point where I can, start recording again, and which I have started recording again. So I was very blessed that even people put their project on hold, while I was going through what I was going through. Hoping that sooner or later I would come out of what I went through and was able to record again. So I still had those projects to do.
That's good. How long did it take you to get back in the throne after the surgery?
It didn't take long, but it was, the other battle was just dealing with COVID. Dealing with COVID, that's, the situation is, it's out there. And not being able to walk into a studio freely without worried about, your surroundings.
Right.
In a building and wearing a mask. And, at that time, and, scientists were still, guessing at it, trying to figure out, how many times you wash your hands, you wear a mask, then you wear, which is the right mask, all that bull crap. Or how many people should be in the room, what's the distance and all that stuff.
Right.
Because when you're in the studio, that all depends on how big that room is. Normally the rooms are pretty small. And so you got to figure out how many people should be in a room according to the size of the room. And, what's the distance, which is 6 feet, the rules were at that time. But prior to 6 feet, it was 10 feet, I think, prior to that. Then it went down to 6 feet. I was just worried about all of that, because of my new liver situation I had to go through.
Makes sense.
If you're getting, any kind of infections or any kind of weirdness in your body, man.
Oh, that's a problem.
Liver transplant, liver survivor. That's not good.
Right. So the interaction between musicians in terms of distance was the least of your concerns, at that particular time. That makes sense. Let's talk drums, because I'm not a drummer, but I wish I could be. I'm but a lowly semi guitar player. How do you define the Dennis Chambers sound?
Dennis Chambers sound is definitely, Billy Cobham, Tony Williams, David Garibaldi, Clyde Stubblefield, Zigaboo Monalise, Jack DeJohnette, Lenny White, and these are all the drummers that came before me. And there's a list of, the list just goes on and on and on. So right. I pretty much listen to everybody. And I believe that, you know, should listen to all styles of music because, you know, I always was curious about learning new things. And by approaching things, you know, or approaching the music like that, I learned that it's not just one way of doing things. You know, like, for instance, like Billy Cobham's technique and the way he plays, the way he understands is totally different than Lenny White. And then Lenny White is different than Tony Williams. And then right. Tony Williams is different from Elvin Jones. Then it's like all these, you know, things, but not one of them is correctly, you know, like the wrong way.
Right.
They just have, they have all different ways of doing this thing and what made them who they are. And one thing I learned from that is, you know, you need to play exactly what you feel and what you hear, or what you hear and what you feel. And growing up, as how old are you?
I am 54.
Okay, so growing up at the, you know, 54, I'm 61. You know, well, we had vinyl records,
right?
And I remember 78s and 33s. But anyway, so, you know, we had vinyl records, so we didn't have YouTube. We didn't have this technology.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Today. And, you know, it's a blessing and a curse what was happening today. The blessing is, you know, you have all this technology, you have all this knowledge right there in front of you on a screen, and all you have to do is just click a button to learn what you need to learn. I mean, right. For instance, if you have questions about anything, if you're trying to put together something or you're trying to figure out something, and you just go to YouTube and just, you know, ask the question and there's a video on, you know.
Right.
But we didn't have that.
I think we were too busy trying to pick up the needle and put it back down in the exact place where we were, exactly. We were trying to learn. I understand.
And pray to God that you put the stylus in the right place, because if you went too far back, then you go, oh, Jesus, now I got to, you know. And then if you want to slow it down, then we have to put coins or weights on the vinyl,
right,
to slow it down.
Right.
Well, now they got YouTube, and it's amazing to me, like, how many musicians are ignorant to the fact of what they're trying to do, or ignorant to the fact that, you know, they don't know too much about music. You know, for instance, like, you know, you talk to a, you know, guy who says, well, how do you learn how to play music? Well, I just create beats. Oh, you create beats, so you don't play drums, physically play? No.
See, and I've never understood that. I mean, I get what they're doing, but at the same time, there's no feel there. There's no, it's not organic, you know, at all.
And that's why. And that's why, because they don't know. They don't know. They never went through the whole concept or the feeling of going through what it feels like to be a musician, as far as like picking up the instrument and learning physically how to play it.
Right.
You know, they just go from here to this.
Right.
Right to the fingers. You know, and it's not physically just going through the motion of hitting the drum or playing the guitar.
Right.
You know, if you're playing bass, you got this. You guitar is this. Keyboards is this. Drums right. is this. They don't know anything about none of that.
Even from the standpoint of tuning a drum kit, you know, I remember sitting and watching one of my drummers just fiddle for 40 minutes, just twisting here, moving this there, moving that there. And I couldn't grasp what was going on until he started playing. And then he kind of nodded to himself and said, okay, now it sounds right. So
yeah,
the organic thing is definitely missing, and I'm a codger and I'm owning it. So I'm okay with that kind of thing. Talking about your sound,
you know, I have to say this too.
Okay.
You know, getting to YouTube, like I said, the one thing is a blessing. The curse is, whoever you are into at that moment, whatever musicians, if you're into Stanley Clark, if you're into Marcus Miller, or whatever have you, and you know, like the curse is, the younger musicians today, they'll look at that one thing, and they only see that one thing. They right. don't see the thing on the left side, the right side, or the left side of the screen. These little captures. And
right.
These little captures, if you click on them, you may just happen to get a history lesson about that person you're looking at.
That makes sense.
And, you know, like if you like Stanley Clark, then you would know something about Dougie Rauch.
Right.
If you like Jaco Pastorius, then you may learn something about the Rock of Prestia. You know,
it's an advanced degree just sitting there on the right side of the screen waiting for you.
Exactly. And all you have to do is click on it. But you know, as we know, the younger generations, they don't want to do any research on anything. They just know what they know at that moment, and then they make it sound like that's the hip thing, and this is the new thing, and that's why they don't know anything. A lot of them don't know anything about what came before. There's a link on YouTube. It's like the first time I heard so-and-so, like if you type in on YouTube, the first time you heard Funkadelic, or the first time you heard the Howe players, or the first time you heard Jimi Hendrix. That was the funny thing, that one. Because, you know, you sitting there watching somebody who's watching Jimi Hendrix for the first time, and they're making comments like, man, he looked like Prince. And then they go like, I wonder if he stole that from Prince, but they're not looking. And the crazy thing is, they're looking at the video, and beneath it, it says what year it was.
Right.
They don't even bother to look to see what year it was.
And they just don't make the connection. It's scary.
Yeah.
It's scary. I worked in a record store briefly when I was about 17, and I was playing the Beatles that day. You know, the older stuff. I saw her standing there, was playing, and this little teenage girl came right up to me and said, you know, hey, who copied Tiffany's song? and I was just, oh, really? I mean, you should never contemplate murdering a fellow teenager in a record store. But, you know, it flashed through my head for just a second there. And you talk about going back, and I'm going to go way back in a second, but you grew up around Baltimore, correct?
Yeah.
So I watched your clip on David Letterman when he was featuring all the different drummers. And the first thing that struck me, and I know very little about the subject, I actually have to thank Dave Grohl for this. The first thing I heard when you started your solo, I heard some go-go in there. And you don't hear a lot, and that makes sense since go-go came from D.C. How did that era affect you musically?
It struck me pretty well, I guess. But the weird thing was, go-go wasn't just D.C. It was like Baltimore-based as well.
I got you.
And, you know, for instance, like when I started, there was a groove I played on Blue Matter, John Scofield record.
Mm-hmm.
And well, that was the same kind of beat that I played with Parliament Funkadelic in the 80s.
Right.
Which came up the weird thing was, not the weird thing, but the thing came up as a groove based that made Chuck Brown successful in this song called Money.
Uh-huh.
But that was something that I played in the 80s.
Huh.
Right? And the song Money didn't come out till like the late part of the 80s or 90s.
Right.
But that was something I played in the 80s.
And that style is really...
And how that came about was that I liked the way Tiki Forward played. Original drummer for Funkadelic. Because he had fast feet.
Right.
I liked the way he played, and he would play some grooves like that. So I just played that groove based on what the feel was in Baltimore, which was the same feel that pretty much came out in Washington. Now, Washington got the claim to fame because they had band. It was band based. They put a band around it. You know, put these percussion guys together, and then you know, going to these jam sessions. You know, with just a bunch of drummers and just played. And then all of a sudden, a bass player. You know, that happened to be in the crowd. And he likes you know what he hears. Then he figured he's going to play a bass line to it. Then Chuck got a hold of it. You know, and there was a few other bands that did it. They weren't well known, but like EU Freeze and stuff like that. That, you know, they made it pop.
I got you. And that style is really, and again, guitar player, that style is really, really based on the feel in the pocket. Am I close to that?
Yeah.
I mean, just that group. Is that something that just stays with you, and it becomes difficult to wander outside of it, regardless of your musical context, or are you able to move around?
Yeah, it stays with you. I mean, because it's a very hypnotic type of groove, you know, or hypnotic feel. Like when you go see Chuck Brown play, man, you can't help but to dance.
Right.
It's like going to Brazil, and you hear samba, or you go to a samba school, which they have down there. And I went to one of those things, man, and it was like around 12 o'clock at night. And it's a big building, you know, where it's got this long stage on it, and it's like, you know, like 30 people, 40 people on the stage, and it's all percussion.
Right.
And they all strike up on this groove, and it's this gigantic open floor, and everybody in the room is dancing. And I'm not a dancer.
Right.
I'm dancing.
Because you can't help yourself.
That's how strong the groove was. I'm dancing. And I'm standing there, you know, I'm dancing with a person. And I'm thinking like, well, wait a minute, I don't even dance. Why am I moving? But I can't stop.
That's a distinct style, because I love that style. And of course, Elvin and Tony and Philly Joe Jones, or, you know, whoever you want to mention, that Billy Cobham. But one of my favorite drummers is Bill Bruford, who's kind of the antithesis of that whole thing. That's coming in from a whole different angle. How does somebody, a pocket drummer like you, see a drummer like his style?
Bill was very, you know, it can be technical, but it also can be non-technical. I don't know how to describe that, but, you know, like some of his works was very, very precise. A lot of his works were very precise, very thought out. Some things were, I mean, it's educational, because, you know, he didn't just play 4/4. He played all kind of weird time signatures and also introducing it into rock music. You know,
right?
Like, yes, it just wasn't a 4/4 band. They were playing all kind of weird time signatures, and making it well known across the world. But if it wasn't for a group like Mahavishnu, none of that would have happened.
Yet another monster. One of these days, where I want to talk to you again just about fusion, because this is. An aside, and I'll go really fast, but when I watched Ken Burns' jazz documentary, and I know how he was guided by Wynton and Stanley Crouch, you know, it's like for him, jazz stopped in 1961. It just went so much further beyond that. And fusion was a dirty word to people, you know, during that era, but there was just so much talent going through that particular period. It's stunning.
Well, you know, it's funny. It's like, you know, when you say that, I mean, especially because what you're saying is true. But, you know, like people, you know, well respect Miles Davis, and rightfully so. But then, you know, they cursed fusion music, and Miles was the founder of it.
Right.
You know, the Bitches Brew records pretty much is a fusion record.
Right.
You know, for the standard of that day, you know. And some people misinterpret the word fusion. Fusion. Sorry.
That's all right. Thought it was me for a second.
This thing off.
Fits for me, I'm not here.
You know, some people misinterpret the word fusion. Fusion is exactly what it is. It's a mixture of all different styles of music, even just fused into one.
Right.
So it's a little bit of jazz, it's a little bit of blues, it's a little bit of rock, it's a little bit of funk. You know?
And it's not even really fair to call it jazz per se, the more I think about that. When I think about Miles in that era, Jack Johnson, the tribute to Jack Johnson is one of my favorites, and that's definitely a fusion.
Yeah. And look who was in that band. It was John McLaughlin.
Right.
Michael, on that record.
Yep. Michael Henderson, who was a Motown bass player.
Yeah.
was on that record. That music's just stunning. And even the stuff, and I'm editorializing, even the stuff he did after that, you know, Alive Evil and what have you, a guard of Black Magus, Pongy, and all that stuff. I'm still trying to figure some of that stuff out.
And with that being said, I mean, look what came out of that. You know, you had people like Billy Cobham, Tony Williams, and John, you know,
right,
who were, you know, furthered that whole fusion thing anyway, you know. So, you know, when Tony Williams did Lifetime with Larry Young and John McLaughlin, you know, that was the first, quote unquote, was supposed to have been the first fusion record.
Right.
But actually, the first fusion record was Miles's, you know, records. You know, when you talk about Bitches Brew and that stuff, and Jack Johnson,
right?
Those were the first fusion records.
Makes sense. Let's go back real quick, and we'll probably revisit the fusion thing. You and Bernie Worrell, who I'm writing the official biography for right now, have something kind of in common in that you started playing really young. Yeah, he started playing piano at 3, and I understand you started playing drums at about 4.
Yeah.
What makes a 4-year-old want to play drums?
Well, at that time, I think it had a lot to do with, you know, when I was in my mother's womb. There was a lot of music around the house, as I understood. You know, so it was just, I guess, being in the womb, hearing all this music and all the dancing that my mom was doing, and she was a professional singer herself. You know, of course, when I was born, still hearing music around the house, you know, being a pain in the butt, as you know, like I was always into something.
Right.
And I mean, that's how I got the name Dennis. And I was a menace, you know, but the only thing that would keep me still was just when my mom had rehearsals at her apartment or at my grandmother's backyard.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, like no matter what was going on around me, and I was always into everything, when they played, that was the only thing that kept me still. And I remember the drum kit. It was a Champagne Sparkle Gretsch kit. It was a 4-piece kit. And he had a rod cymbal and a crash cymbal, a hi hat. And I even remember the guy's name. His name was Booney. Now I'm 4 years old, or actually, I wasn't even 4 yet. I was like maybe 3, going on 4.
Right.
And I remembered all of that. And I think the thing that struck me the most was just the guy was hitting on something that was shiny. You know,
right,
these shiny glitter drums and these shiny gold looking things that were cymbals and the sound that it was making. So, of course, when he leaves, when rehearsal was over, I would pick up knives and forks and now I'm banging. I'm trying to mimic him.
Right.
You know, banging, banging, banging. So my parents realized that they should buy a drum kit, you know, because they noticed that every time that band would come around or any drummer would come around, I would just sit and watch. And, you know, sitting there mimicking, you know, what I'm seeing, even like looking at his hands and trying to get my hand to look like that, you know.
Right.
You know, learning how to grip the sticks and all that stuff. And so they brought a drum kit that was trashed because of my neighborhood friends trashed the kit, which threw me in some kind of depression until they brought me a real kit at the age of 4. And I haven't looked back since.
Nice.
Listening to all this beautiful music that was around me and learning from just listening to these beautiful pieces of music, you know, like with the Motown and the Stax recordings and, you know, Miles Davis and, you know, Jimi Hendrix and, I think it's the 60s where, you know, I mean, Dede Warwick, you know,
right,
Famous Fool and all that kind of stuff. There was just a lot of beautiful, Sam and Dave, there was a lot of beautiful, beautiful music. And, you know, I wanted to learn how to do that. I wanted to learn how to play that music. So the only way I could figure it out or to learn it. It's just been listen and just use my imagination to what I hear, what was going on.
Makes sense.
I'm a self-taught musician. I didn't go to school for any of this. In fact, I still don't even know. I don't know how to read music, which kind of fascinates people because I'm on a lot of recording and some movie scores. But, you know, that's okay, you know, because, you know, like, and I'm not saying it's okay because this guy did it, but Buddy Rich didn't know how to read music.
Right.
A lot of people didn't know that. You know, he didn't know how to read music. Lenny White don't know how to read music. There's a lot of non-readers out there, but they're just as important as the guy who reads.
Oh, agree.
And I was taught from some musicians, they rather have somebody who don't read. I mean, once they read it and once they retain it, okay, you got it. But they don't want to see a guy on the bandstand. Like, I'm trying to imagine you're looking at a funk band, they're playing funk, and everybody's sitting there reading.
that's contradictory. Yeah, that's contradictory at best. I mean, I'm not saying I discourage an education, but it almost seems like it's almost better in many ways just to have a feel for it than anything else. That's just become part of the music instead of, like you said, just staring at a chart and okay, the kick drum comes here, or you know, this riff comes there. You know, that makes sense. You started gigging at 9, I understand.
No, I started gigging at 6.
6, you win.
Yeah, I was in the nightclub.
Okay. Tell me about that.
Well, it was a band called the Fingertips, as I remember. Fingertips, somehow they heard me, the bass player, his name was Rat, I think his name was. I don't know why they called him Rat, but his name was Rat. And he was happened to be coming home one day, and on Preston Street, where we used to live, it was, for some strange reason, there was a lot of traffic on the street at a certain time of day. And he heard some drumming going on, and he needed a drummer for the band.
Right.
So he pulled over and knocked on the door, and my mom came to the window. We were living on the second, third floor of this apartment. She came to the door and came to the window, and the guy asked who's playing drums, and she said it was a son and blah 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 blah. So she took him up to see me play, and he asked her. Would she mind if he would take me to this rehearsal to, you know, introduce me to these guys and let these guys hear me play? One thing led to another. The guys were, you know, kind of spellbound that, you know, somebody at that age could play a groove.
Which is what I was coming to. How old were they on average?
They were older. I mean, they were. To me, I think they were like in their mid-20s or something.
That's got to be a shock to walk in and see someone that young. A first grader, literally. A literal first grader, you know, playing that way.
And then somehow they saw it as well as like a little novelty thing where, you know, they can get people to come to see this young kid that can play songs.
Right.
And the songs were like Sam and Dave, Knock on Wood, stuff like that. But not only just to play it, but the feel. You know, I understood the feel of it because I guess that came with the, you know, just being in my mom's womb, you know, just hearing things. And I guess I felt it from there. You know, I felt what it felt like to hear something and plus, I, you know, like the first rhythms you hear anyway is your mother's heartbeat.
And you always hit the boop, boop,
boop, boop, boop, boop. You do that long. I mean, you hear that long enough. Who knows? I mean, then maybe that's the reason why kids move around in their mom's stomach because they hear that. And maybe they're just grooving in there.
Right. That makes sense. And you were offered a chance to play with James Brown, I understand, relatively young.
Yeah, I was 13. That came about. James Brown used to have this motor in downtown Baltimore. It was called the James Brown Motor Inn, which ended up being something else. And he also had a radio station. He was part of web radio, WEBB.
Right.
And he just happened to be in town one day. I was playing with this cover band, and we happened to be playing at his establishment. I go to the bathroom on break, and there's a guy in the stall, like, singing some words, but you can't make out what the words were.
Right.
You know, that kind of thing. And he comes out of the stall, and he goes to the sink, and I'm using, you know, doing my thing. And I go to the sink, and I'm washing my hands, and this guy's still, he's picking out his hair, you know, still singing something or mimicking words. And I'm like, man, who's this guy? And I looked in the mirror, see him, looked down, looked up again. I realized it was Mr. Brown. And I'm like, I didn't know what to say to him. I'm like, Mr. Brown, you know, stuttering, trying to gather my thought on words. And I introduced myself to him. He never looked at me. He's still picking up and saying, yeah, kid, yeah, you know, even talking.
Right.
I told him I was playing at his place, and we're at the ballroom or the club or whatever that was there. And, you know, it would be an honor if he came to see it. He said, yeah, kid, I may come, you know, blah, 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 blah. You know, I just came to do some business and blah, 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 blah. So I went back and told the band. They didn't believe me. Of course, they didn't believe me. And sure enough, somewhere in the night, we're up on the bandstand, and this door opened up, and this entourage of people come in, and they go in this one corner, and they filled up two tables as they sit there. And then all of a sudden, right when the band ended the thing, this one guy came over to me, and he looked like a freaking wall. He was so huge. He comes over to me, and he goes like, hey, Mr. Brown requests your presence at his table. And I'm looking back at the band like, I told you. And they're looking all shocked, you know.
Right.
And I go over there, and he's like, yeah, kid, that sounds great. How old are you? I told him, I was like, man. You know, like, how do you feel like, you know, putting your backbeat to Mr. Brown's music? Man, I was like, I almost did a somersault at the table, you know. Yeah, of course, you know. It would be great. But then all of a sudden, the reality hit me that, you know, I had to go, you know, somebody had to go and talk to my mom about that one.
Right.
And he says, yeah, your mom, you gotta talk to your mom. I'm like, yeah, well, you gotta talk to my mom. So I gave him the number. And I think like a month went by, because every day I came home, like, you know, anybody call? Mr. Brown call? Nobody call. And then I gave up on the whole idea. Like, he's just bullshit, you know.
Right.
And then all of a sudden the phone rang one day, and it was him. Or it wasn't him. It was somebody at the office, his office.
Right.
Called and was like, Mr. Brown's office, da-da-da-da. It's Dennis Chambers. I'm like, this is Dennis. And I got my mom on the phone. He was on the phone talking to my mom. My mom, she made me leave the room while she talked to her. And she declined the whole thing, you know, because Mr. Brown wouldn't offer a tutor for me to go on and play with him, which I thought was very odd because he was a strong advocate of education at that time.
Hmm. There's a bit of an irony.
But thank God I didn't do it, because as I found out later, you know, while playing with Funkadelic, Mr. Brown was a piece of work.
It seems like some of the biggest geniuses are some kind of piece of work. It's just something that you have to endure. But at 13, you know, maybe not so much.
Nah, he probably, you know, as the band, like Bootsy and Maceo and Fred, you know, they felt like he probably would have ruined me.
Yeah,
they had a hard time dealing with it.
Right. Makes sense. And Boosie was in his early 20s, I want to say, when he joined the band in that neighborhood.
Yeah.
So that makes sense. Still, a 13-year-old being asked to join James Brown's band has some kind of discipline going on. Can you tell me about your practice routine? Has it evolved over the years? Or what exactly do you do to get those kind of chops together?
Man, well, I mean, of course, it takes practice. I mean, you know, like, it takes the discipline to sit there and just play something very simple for a long period of time and just stay focused, just playing that one thing at very slow tempo. And then also in the same concept, it takes takes something and play it as fast as you can at a certain tempo, as fast as you can and precise as you can at a certain tempo,
right?
Or at a tempo, fast tempo. But also, you know, the idea of having somebody like Buddy Rich that was around, very visible, and as a well-known player as he was, it gave you the idea to try to approach him, or try to approach things from try to approach things, you know, as a technical,
right?
Better word, technical standpoint, you know, and also to one thing I learned about, you know, looking at somebody like Buddy Rich and Billy Cobham, guys who had like phenomenal chops. They were very precise, and you can hear every stick beat, every time you hit that drum, you can hear it,
right?
And you can hear the distinction between the left and right hand.
And that's interesting. And how could you tell the difference there?
Well, because of rudiments.
Okay.
If you learn rudiments, you know, rudiments is just, you know, left and right hand coordinations.
Right.
You know, like paradiddle. If you can say paradiddle, you can play it. Because the diddle only gets two beats. Everything else is one beat. Per, ra. I don't even see that. Per, yep. Ra, did, do. Per, ra, did, do.
Okay. That makes sense.
So if you play them, if you understood rudiments, you can hear what they were doing.
You okay. Know? And then just build from that. I was going to ask, since you didn't read, you know, whether... how you went about learning the rudiments. Cause in fact, I was thinking flams, paradiddles, that kind of thing. But I think you just answered that question.
Yeah. And not only that, it's like when somebody, you know, when you learning rudiments, the sticking is at the bottom of the notes. It says left, right, left, left, right, left, right, right.
I gotcha.
And then flams is, you know, you see the right stick, if it's a right hand lead, it's the right stick first, and then the left hand follows.
Okay.
You know, with a space.
Right.
Blop, 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 you know.
Like
sticking is right there. So that was very easy to
okay. Learn. Makes sense. It's like a guitar player, you know, learning to read tablature as opposed to actually reading the notes. You know, okay, here's the third fret on the fourth string. Here's, you know, and that kind of thing. You know, I know which string is which unless you do a different form of tuning, but yeah, that makes sense. It's a similar vibe. The first big professional gig, what was that and how did you get there?
I was in the union. I was always in the union. In fact, that reminds me, I got to pay my union. But I was in the union at a very young age. And sometimes when groups would come through, certain types of groups come through, you know, like in the union, they didn't have, you know, certain musicians that could do those kind of things. And better, what I'm trying to say is, you know, in Baltimore, it was more like they catered to the white people to get those gigs.
Right.
Always white people get the gigs. But if you got somebody like the Eddie Kendricks or the Temptations. Sometimes the Temptations didn't have a drummer, or the Spinners didn't have a drummer, and
right.
You know, like they grab bands as they're going through on tour. And it all depends on if they were on tour with their own unit or if they were just on a promotional tour. So with that being said, you know, like since I am a black drummer who studied that music, you know, so they would just call me up versus to call in some white guy who don't know anything about that music or don't, you know, express that kind of feel.
Right.
So at the, you know, age of 14 or 15, I was doing gigs at the Civic Center. Not a lot, you know, but I was doing some gigs at the Civic Center. And then the word get back, you know, like people who saw that show and they see this young drummer playing. Of course, they're gonna, if they had kids, they tell their kids, like, there was a kid there who's like your age who was playing drums. He sounded great, blah, blah. And then the kids will go to school and they go like, you know, or parents who had kids at that school, you know, they would, the students would come in and go like, man, were you at a did you play somewhere last night? You know, and I'm like, yeah, I played. Like, were you at the Civic Center? Yeah, I was at the Civic. I knew it was you. You know, and then they go back to tell their parents, like, they go to school. They went to school with this guy who did that show that night. You know, so.
Well, that's got to earn you some points in school. A couple of cool points here and there.
Yeah. But I was reading. I was a little shy guy too, so I didn't really want to, you know, bring any kind of attention to myself when it came to that.
Fair enough.
You know, when you get attention, sometimes you get problems.
That's also the best kind of musician, the low key one who just does what he does and moves along.
Yeah.
As a guitarist, you know, I was looking at this who's who list of guitar players you played with, whether it's Mike Stern or John McLaughlin or John Scofield and Santana and Tony McAlpine, Scott Henderson, Greg Howe. You've gotten that fusion. I don't want to say label, but you've gotten that fusion technical skill set together. How long did it take for you to put that kind of put those kind of chops together to get the attention of those kind of guitar players?
Good question. I always had the chops or the ability to do it, especially after hearing somebody like Mahavishnu. I mean, because when I heard that, when I saw that, man, boy, it blew me away, man. It's like, I honestly can tell you, when I saw the Mahavishnu, or when I saw Miles Davis with Tony Williams in band at a young age, I couldn't sleep for 48 hours.
Wow.
I really couldn't sleep for 48 hours. And not understanding why I could not sleep, you know, because, I mean, when I saw it and when I heard it, it was something that was just mind-blowing to me. Because when I saw Miles play, I didn't understand jazz.
Right.
But I knew I was seeing something unbelievable. I mean, because when I walked out of that building, man, I was blown. I didn't hear anything else but that.
Right.
And I still remember, you know, Tony Williams, he was playing a white satin drum set, a Gretsch drum kit. And Tony played like the cops were outside waiting for him. And the way it sounded, it almost sounded like it was the Tony Williams band featuring Miles Davis.
Right.
From a drummer standpoint. You know,
that's what makes it sense.
Like, I couldn't sleep, man. And Mahavishnu was like that. You know, when you heard the records, was one thing that was, and that was just mind blowing. But then when you heard him play live, it just blew your head right off.
Was it a question of you trying to learn the licks, or was it just the overall scope of the music that was keeping you awake?
The overall scope of the music, how it all fit, and not knowing the concept of what it was, because it was all new to me.
Right.
You know, and I mean, here I am, I'm playing at this club, the same club where Miles played, I'm playing at this club, and I'm playing, you know, I'm a soul man, you know, I'm a soul man. Mr. Baker, the owner, was telling me, you know, he called me Shorty. Shorty, you want to hear a great band play, you know, come back on Saturday, you know, you got to hear this band, blah, 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 blah.
Right.
And then I wanted to go and check it out. So I went down there and checked it out. And it was a mind changer.
Completely on a different level from what you were used to.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
And believe me, I was listening to, you know, or jazz music was played around the house, but when I actually saw it, then it hit me.
Right.
You know, my mother was always listening to jazz and always listening to all these styles of music, because at that time, as you know, when you were growing up, music was just played on AM stations.
Right.
And there weren't that many stations on AM.
Right.
Here in Baltimore, at least.
St. Louis was pretty similar.
Say again?
I said St. Louis was pretty similar. So, yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah. So you had, and then you had your white stations and you had your black stations.
Right.
And you know, white people didn't want to listen to black music at that time.
Right.
And they didn't, you know, they didn't want to have nothing to do with, you know, anything black, you know, then.
Right.
You know, I mean, for instance, like you have like somebody like Little Richard, you know, who's one of the founders of rock. And you would hear him, you know, he would put out something like Lucille or whatever. And then, you know, like a month later, you hear Pat Boone's version. But Pat Boone's version is played on the white station.
That's exactly where I was going. Yep.
Yeah. And then you have Little Richard on the black station. But Pat Boone made Little Richard more money than him doing it himself.
Right.
And then, but the crazy thing was, the confusion was, white people heard Little Richard version like years later, and they go like, well, why is he ripping off, you know, Pat Boone?
Yeah, they've got it back completely backward.
Yeah. And they've always had it completely backwards.
Right.
But hey, look, you know, we are our own victims, you know, because we allow it to happen, you know.
Right.
Like, you know, how do you let, you know, like a white culture, you know, to try to explain jazz, like they're the authority on jazz music.
It makes sense. Speaking of jazz, as a drummer and, you know, again, guitar player, I'm 54 and I still feel like I'm still learning. How easy was it for you to differentiate jazz drummers, say an Elvin Jones from a Max Roach, from a Tony Williams, you know, from an Art Blakey?
Well, let me see. Let me go to Roy Haynes. Roy Haynes is, you know,
and a Roy Haynes.
Yeah. Let's go back to Max Roach. Max Roach, since he was the, you know, they're one of the founders of bebop music. Which is coming out of, you know, like the first things with like Louis Armstrong and stuff like that, the stuff that came out of New Orleans. But, you know, you had somebody like, you know, like Max Roach, who was very precise. He had a crazy, crazy right hand, you
right.
know, on a rod cymbal that played a dotted eighth note like nobody's business. Ding, 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 you know.
Right.
And everything sounded like it was just mapped out. Where Elvin Jones... let me go back. Where Roy Haynes would play, you know, the same style, because he went back there with him too, you know, as one of the founders of bebop.
Right.
And you hear his rod cymbals the way he played the rod cymbals was a little different than Max. But what made his thing, you know, was, you know, just very distinctive is his left hand. His left hand, how his left hand answered to the right hand. It was a question and answer thing, the way I saw it. Or the way I understood Roy Haynes.
Right.
Right. Elvin Jones' thing was just loose as hell. I mean, he was more triplet oriented.
Right.
Where sometimes his feels, you know, the way he plays, you know, some people described it as it just sounds sloppy. And then other people said it sounded like a tennis shoe in a dryer. You know,
right?
And he just came out of it. It was just the way he came out, the way he started, the way he came out was just mind blowing, especially at that time because nobody played like that. But
right.
When he came on board, a lot of people didn't like it. I don't know if a lot of people knew that, but they hated it in New York.
Huh? I didn't know.
They hated. Huh?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, they hated him, you know. And, of course, they're going to hate, you know, somebody who's totally different than the norm. And at that time, the norm was Max Roach and Roy Haynes.
Makes sense.
You know, who came out of, you know, the Big Sid Catlett and Papa Joe Jones.
Now
and
then, does...
you know, you had Philly Joe, you know, who came into that.
Right.
So Elvin was just totally different from all of that. He just loosened things up. He just made it, as Carlos Santana would say, you know, Elvin, like listening to Elvin is like listening to music, you know, being very elastic.
Okay.
Groove just stretches. And by listening to him, if you play funk music, you know, you bring that feeling into it. And that's what, you know, playing in pockets or put it in the pocket. That's that same kind of concept, but not as busy.
Gotcha.
Where the left hand, it's like a flam to the right hand. Now, the right hand is keeping time if you're playing higher, you know.
Right.
But if you're playing backbeats, you know, on the snare drum is like it's not on the beat. It's a little bit behind the beat.
Okay.
Which give it that elastic feeling.
Now, does
like the, if you listen to Delphonics, for instance.
Right.
Delphonics is a perfect example of that. You know, when you hear Didn't I Blow Your Mind This Time?
Okay.
It's so relaxed. And the reason why it's so relaxed is because where that where the drummer places his snare drum beats.
That makes sense. And that's something you don't think about necessarily when you're listening to the Delphonics. You're caught up in the vocal portion of it.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Also, when I listen to it, you know, I'm like, I remember being just blown away when I first heard it because of the production.
Right.
You know, with the French horns and the strings and everything was real. It wasn't, you know, the synthesizers weren't even, you know, they weren't making those kind of sounds then. I don't think they existed at that time, but I'm not sure. I can't remember that.
Certainly
but
not in that context.
They had, huh?
I say certainly not in that context. I mean, I think synthesizers of the 60s and 70s. I'm thinking of, you know, Wendy Carlos playing, you know, Bach tunes and what have you on a Moog synthesizer, but which is not the Delphonics by any stretch of the imagination.
So, now, but I mean, just to, you know, when you drop that needle on that record, when you listen to one of those songs, you know, you get a feel, and the feel. It was based on, you know, what was played, the instrumentation that was there, the real horns and the real strings and the, you know, you could hear the bass very distinctively, there you go. And and then you got this drummer who's like playing so behind the beat with the left hand, you know, that brought it all together. Cause the band is playing on the beat, but the snare drum is just a tad behind.
Right. Now, what I'm wondering is, does a drummer's style ultimately depend on who's, quote-unquote, the front man of the band, the leader of the band? For example, is Elvin sound because he could do it behind Coltrane, or could he get away with the same thing behind Miles or Dizzy or Monk, something like that?
Elvin could do that with anybody, but it's just the fact that if the artist is willing to hear that, like if Miles was willing to hear Elvin with him.
Right.
Or better yet, if Elvin were to play with Miles Davis at that time, would Miles let him, you know, do what he does or do what he did? Or would he try to turn him into like a Philly Joe Jones?
I gotcha.
You know, guys like that.
Okay.
Because, I mean, he, you know, when Elvin came on the scene, he was, I mean, a lot of people criticized him.
Right.
Because he didn't sound like Max. He didn't sound like, you know, all the guys came before.
So
he came in with a strong voice right from the bat.
And that's an adjustment. I mean, Art Blakey was leading his band, so he could pretty much do, you know, whatever he felt like doing at the time. Would it be harder for, I'm just wondering how many drummers could interchange with one another, you know, could Tony Williams move from Miles, you know, to Train, you know, and take Elvin's role and vice versa. It just struck me as an interesting idea.
Well, there was rumors that Tony played with Miles. I kind of remember asking Tony about that, but I can't remember what was the answer. But there was rumors that he did play with him, and I think he did. Somebody said they saw it.
Right.
And with him. And it was just different.
Right.
You know, he played the music, but it was just different. And he wasn't trying to, and I can't even imagine him trying to play like Tony, play like Elvin.
Right.
You know, that's a hard thing to do.
I would imagine.
And not only that, why would you want to do that? Especially if you got your own concept.
Makes sense. You talk about a time when YouTube would have been ideal, was just going around up and down 52nd Street and all these different clubs and just listening to one band after another and hearing the same set list that's a completely different set list when they start playing. You know, you recognize the theme and then they're off and running someplace else. That's got to be crazy. Is there any style for you that feels a little less comfortable than a different style does, something you may struggle with a little bit more?
Latin music.
Okay.
Because now, I can play Latin music, but when you go to places like Bahia, and when you go to South America, you know, and fool around, you know, around there, but then you notice like Bahia is totally different than, or the music there is totally different, or the rhythm there is totally different than anywhere else in South America.
I got you.
You know, when you listen to Wawa Coles and things like that, you know, or Montunos and stuff like that, it's totally different than here. Somebody who lived and breathed it versus somebody who, like, you know, like sit there and read it and try right. to play it.
It's unnatural.
They play the part right, because they play exactly what was written,
right?
But they don't feel the same as a person who lived and breathed it, you know.
I would imagine it's a question of touch. I would imagine it's a question of touch too. When you it's one thing to read the notes, but it's something else to play them with just the right amount of intensity.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's funny you said Latin, because the first thing that popped into my head was, my God, you were with Santana for how long? A decade or longer? But the Latin you're mentioning is even further south.
Yeah. Carlos is more like that's a Latin rock or Latin. It's Latin based.
Right.
You know, but it's more like Latin rock.
No, that's fair. What do you look for in a good band leader? Or put another way, what do you think makes a good band leader as opposed to what makes a not-so-good leader?
A guy who's willingness to listen to other people's thoughts. A guy who's willing to let people express themselves. You know? Like, I mean, for instance, like, what I'm trying to say is, like, somebody like George Duke.
Right.
Who I miss very dearly. What made George so successful is the fact that he hired people and let people come in and do what, you know, what he hired them to do. And that was the reason why Miles Davis became so successful. You know, of course, Miles was famous for writing music, you know, some of the stuff they wrote. But that music wouldn't have the effect if he didn't let these people do what they do. First of all, Miles didn't hire Herbie Hancock and then try to tell Herbie how to play. How do you tell Herbie Hancock how to play?
That doesn't make sense.
Right. Or like, you know, if Coltrane hired Elvin, how do you tell Elvin how to play? How is Coltrane going to tell him how to do that? Or how is somebody going to try to tell Coltrane how to play?
Right.
So, I mean, people hire people. Back then, they hire people to do what they do. You know, we're living in, this is like 2021, and people hire people and they hire them to try to get them to sound like somebody else. Where when we grew up, when we were kids, the end thing was not to try to sound like somebody else.
Right.
And if you notice, when you turn on a radio station, pretty much everything sounds the same. The same instruments, the same vibe, formula. It's the same. Like if you took Motown, for instance, Motown and Stax Recordings or Stax Industry. If you took Motown, for example, and you list on, I mean, name all the bands that, or all the groups that came out of Motown. Name them.
Right. Like the Temptations or Martha and the Vandellas or the Supremes or you're quizzing me now, even the Jackson 5, early Stevie Wonder, Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, and so on and so on.
The point of that is, did they all sound the same?
They had similar backbeats, I would say. They had the principle was very similar.
Right, but did they sound the same?
Nah.
Did the Temptations sound like the Four Tops?
I wouldn't go that far.
Yeah, or did the Supremes sound like anybody else?
Right, there was still a distinct voice there. Right.
The music, although it was the same musicians, and the same writers, but the musicians somehow made that stuff sound different than the other thing. And right. You may hear some similarities in some of that stuff, but basically, you know, like Sugar Pie Honey,
Sugar Pie Honey Bunch. Yeah.
Sugar Pie, you know, it didn't sound like Papa Rose was a Rolling Stone.
Not even remotely.
Right. And the Jacksons didn't sound, their music didn't sound like the Miracles.
Right.
Stevie Wonder didn't sound like, you know, and I mean, Stevie Wonder didn't sound like nobody, you know, his music didn't sound like, you know, anybody else in that band or in that organization. And Marvin Gaye came along. I mean, Marvin Gaye didn't come along, but Marvin Gaye was there.
He was there, yeah.
And his stuff, I mean, the earlier Marvin Gaye music sounded similar to some of that stuff, but the later Marvin Gaye, like What's Going On, all that stuff, no.
Right. See, and I would make the same argument about Stevie Wonder, because he wasn't the same between, say, 67, 68, and 72. That my favorite little pocket between 71 and 76, where Stevie could do no wrong, you know, whether it was Music of My Mind or Talking Book or Songs in the Key of Life or Inner Visions. I mean, he and Marvin found themselves, I think, within that realm. It wasn't just about making hits. It was about actually speaking to what was happening in society.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, man.
Which is a beautiful thing, and that all that being said, you know, T-shirt aside, I'm a Stax cat, you know, I'm Al Green and you know, and Isaac Hayes and what have you. You know, I thought that sound, it wasn't as pop driven to me. These were cats that could flat out play, and that was put up front, you know, in addition to the vocalists.
Yep, exactly. Man.
But that's a conversation we're going to have at length, you know, another day, because that's an hour in and of itself. I'm not going to ask you for your favorite gig, because it's like trying to pick your favorite child. But a couple of gigs that you've really enjoyed over the years, musicians you've enjoyed playing with.
P-Funk, for sure. John McLaughlin. Mike Stern. Steely Dan. I mean, they're all my favorites, actually.
That's fair.
Yeah, they're all my favorites. I had a good time musically and being on tour with those guys. You know, living the tour with them.
Anything?
Huh?
Anything in particular stick out? Anything in particular stick out? Any events? Any happenings that you're willing to share publicly?
Good thing you said that.
I gave you an out. I'm just saying.
I got this on videotape, so I guess I can mention this. But there was one time the mothership came down on fire one night, and George Clinton, you know, because back then it was real lights. They weren't those LED bulbs. They were real hot bulbs.
Right.
And sometimes the stage would get like 110 degrees.
Right.
You know, it depends on how ventilated the building was. And so we couldn't wait for the mothership to come down because it would cool off the stage. But anyway, so just one night it came down and the gel caught fire. One of the gels caught fire.
Yikes.
And caused the thing to start burning. Now, George is inside the staircase and he's locked in from the outside.
Right.
And I'm throwing drumsticks trying to get his attention. And he was in there, you know, getting himself, you know, zooted for him to come out, you know, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Properly prepared, you know, situationally oriented. Let's go with that.
But yet he was getting his wig tight.
That works too.
So he's in there doing his thing and the drumstick went in and he picks it up and he turns around and he gives me the P-Funk sign and I'm going like, no, look up. And he looks up and he sees the thing. Now he can't get out from, because the thing is locked from the outside, like I said. So he pulls himself out of it, you know, by jumping up, grabbing the top of the staircase and pulls himself out. And he jumps. And he got caught by a nail or something, caught his uniform. He had a one-piece leotard thing on.
Uh-oh.
And make a long story short, you know, things didn't work. It didn't go well that night. And I don't know how to finish that story, but Fast forward a little bit to that. One night he came out of the spaceship, you know, with a sheet on. And oh, now for Lord. Me, all I could see was the back. All I saw was it looked like a cape.
Right.
From what I saw. And when I looked down on the bandstand, you know, I could see guys falling into the amps. Everybody in the front line was laughing.
Right.
He came out of the spaceship naked, wearing nothing other than that sheet. And he had the sheet draped behind him like a cape. And he's standing there like Superman with his fist on his hips.
You know, I'm pretty sure there were laws against that back then.
The thing is, Funkadelic, you know, at that time, you know, like you would go to these concerts, Funkadelic can do anything, and the excuse was, oh, it's the funk, you know. Like,
right.
I mean, I remember joining that band when I was 18 and seeing, you know, like these guys were smoking marijuana on stage, giving each other shotguns on stage. And I'm thinking, we're going to jail tonight. We're going to jail. Because right. That was unheard of back then, especially a black group.
Right. And I guess anything goes, you know, back in those days. I'm going to wrap this up on you because we've been going at this for a while, and I've enjoyed this. But is there anything you'd like to see of young musicians, specifically drummers, these days that you're not seeing enough of?
Yeah, I mean, I just wish they would. A lot of guys, or I wish the younger musicians just do some research on whatever instrument that they're playing or whatever music that they're listening to. Just do some research.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. Once you're not going to believe this, but I actually have to answer the phone. Hang on 1 second.
There you go.
Hello. Oh, great. Could you just have me bring it up and leave it at the door and I'll pick it up in a second. Thank you. The beauty of my building, they let me know when deliveries are coming up. I love Chicago. Anyway, one last question. I was just thinking of, I was going back and forth on whether or not I wanted to ask you, are you into movies at all?
Not that much. No.
Okay. I was going to ask, doggone it, she's calling again. Hang on. Hello. Oh, yeah, okay. Just having my knock on the door. Give me 2 minutes and I'll take care of it. Thanks. And he needs to see my ID. But obviously, we'll be doing some judicious editing here. But I was going to ask you if you saw the movie Whiplash and what you thought about it.
The movie with the drummers?
Yeah.
I saw the movie. I can't remember what my feelings when I first saw it. I know it was something that I didn't experience growing up being a drummer.
Right.
And I thought it was just, it couldn't have been, I don't know if it was a true or a documentary, not a documentary. I don't know if it was something that was, you know, somebody had experienced themselves.
Right.
You know, it's one of those kind of movies, or it was just something that was just written.
Makes sense.
I remember liking the movie. I liked the movie.
Right.
And I guess I liked it because it was something about drummers, I guess.
Fair enough. Yes, well, we'll circle back into that. But I, alas, because of other things, have to wrap this up. But I do appreciate you taking the time.
All right.
And I would love to do this again. And I thank you very much on behalf of myself and Make Weird Music. And this was Dennis Chambers. If you don't know his music, start paying attention to it because it's everywhere. And I mean, it's everywhere. So take care of yourself and we'll talk again soon.
You do the same. You do the
Thank
same.
You.